Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Happy Wednesday. Let's give a couple minutes here for folks to join up. What's up, you guys? How's everybody doing? Thanks for being here. Look, we've got a special guest joining us in just a couple of minutes. And as you know, we have been gathering here every so often to talk about the rise in violence against Asian American Pacific Islanders and what can be done to stop it. So I'm gonna bring in our guest. He can join us now. Hopefully we'll see him pop up in a second. Thanks for joining, guys. And there he is. Hey, Bing Chen, how are you doing?
I'm so tired, to be honest, but hanging in there.
This is a safe space. We want honesty.
It's a privilege to be here, though. No, thank you for having me.
Well, you're a hardworking man and you're a busy man, so I'm not surprised that you are tired. But thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
We gather here every so often. We take people's questions and we just want to keep this conversation going because this rise that we've seen in anti-Asian violence over the last year is something we are continuing to talk about as we continue to see it. But we also want to talk about solutions. We want to talk about what's being done, organize and activate people and really kind of bring the community together. So you, we should say, are the president and co-founder of Gold House, which I want to talk about a little bit more in just a second. But let's just start at the beginning. I want to hear about you. I want you to tell people out there about yourself, where you're from, where you grew up, your family, whatever you want to share. Go for it.
I'm very flattered. As an Asian from the South, it is awkward to talk about oneself, but I'll try my best.
I can relate.
Touché. Thank you so much for creating this continued space as well, especially because there's so much, intersectionality. By the way, you'll forgive me. I surprised my mother for her 70th. I'm in our house and there's 50 of us in here. So you'll forgive that.
Oh my gosh. Let's meet the family. Where is everybody?
Let's not. Anyway, in all seriousness, I was born in Tennessee. I was raised in middle school in Shanghai. And I spent my final formative years in Orange County, California, which is where I'm unfortunately now being kicked out. But I'm a third culture kid, which means
mama's house. You got to find space for yourself. Gosh,
this is a metaphor of being raised by a tiger mother. You have to earn your way everywhere. Nowhere is free. But in all seriousness, I think it's informed a lot of how I see identity, because I think a lot of people either grew up not feeling explicit racism or feeling a ton of it. And I felt something in between, because obviously when you're in Tennessee, you might think that you feel a lot of racism, but you find that racism actually persists in more diverse cities. So I actually never felt truly sort of ostracized when I was a child in Tennessee. In fact, I loved it. When I was in Shanghai, of course, everyone is Asian. So it sort of broadens your mind into what's possible because the center of gravity looks like it. So that was me. I think because I was a third culture kid and felt at home everywhere and nowhere, I wanted to constantly be able to sort of help others self-realize or help others manifest their dreams. So professionally, my dream since I was a boy is to be the next Walt Disney. So that's that, who I thought, you know, could build dreams at the highest level. Also, Mickey Mouse, I thought was Disney when I was three. And I thought Mickey Mouse, because I was three, an idiot. And Mickey Mouse, I thought was Asian because Mickey Mouse has black hair and his skin tone was like me. I'm so embarrassed. Sorry. Anyway, we are literally just real time. I did not expect this to happen, by the way. Just fast forward. My last first job was at YouTube. I built most of the creator ecosystem worldwide. It was just an amazing sort of birth of influencer marketing, $50 billion industry. And the whole thrust behind it was, how do we enable, you know, in this case now, 500 million creative artists and entities to realize their ambitions if you feel like others. And that carries, of course, forward today to all of my portfolio companies. How do you enable anyone, whether you're lacking sleep and in your mother's home with 5,000 people, or, you know, you're trying to galvanize the diaspora that, even though we're the majority of the world, have been grossly under-researched, underserved, underrepresented, least likely to be promoted to management. How do you galvanize them in a meaningful way?
Well, tell me about that experience at YouTube, because I think for to understand where you are now, you kind of have to understand the incredible work you did there, because you led their first creator team, right? Which was a huge thing for YouTube. And you were very young when you were doing it. So tell me a little bit about how that came about and how that informed the work you wanted to do from there.
Yeah, I mean, the stacks were completely, what is it? The English is not my first language, so I'm not good with metaphors, but the chips were stacked against us, as it were. I was 23. I had no reports. I had effectively influenced 55 people twice my age with Harvard Business School degrees and control a $100 million budget. And honestly, I think the reason this happened was, one, no one cared about what we were doing, because at the time, candidly, everyone at YouTube wanted to be Netflix. You know, you basically license a bunch of premium content, use that as a Trojan horse for originals. And everyone looked at what they called down market creators, which I was obsessed with, as garbage. So I think we just didn't have a lot of eyeballs on us, so we were able to move freely. I think the second came from principle. In hindsight now, we take the democratization of distribution for granted, right? But back then, it was much less obvious. Mobile hadn't proliferated. Broadband costs were still pretty cost prohibitive for certain regions. But the other piece that I think was less obvious in hindsight, but one that we were really passionate about, was the democratization of creation. Mm-hmm. And when you're trying to create a new industry, as you know better than anyone, if you look at what currently exists and you try to flip it, imagine what if all the rules were inverted, what would happen? And so we looked at effectively news, music, Hollywood, and so forth, and said, what if there were no literal walls in Burbank? What if anyone could get greenlit? What if anyone could reach any stage and not have to call AEG and Live Nation for every concert? And that's effectively what we built. And that philosophy of how do you not just democratize access, but democratize creation, as soft as it sounds, if you can materialize in the trinity of audience, commerciality to sustain it, and then also creatively, because these are artists, so they have to actually be taken very seriously. Mm-hmm. You have something really, really special.
And that intersection of storytelling, creation, innovation, that all kind of helped feed into this idea of what Gold House is and what it can be. And so today, when you identify yourself, I love this term, you say you are an impact entrepreneur. What does that mean?
It's what my management coach said I had to say, because I was tired of explaining what I do. Because Disney sounds overzealous and a bunch of nouns just feels awkward to me, because I'm just here to do things. You know, like I'm not one of those kids who was 10 years old and said, I need to be CEO. That's not me. I'm here to make everyone's dreams come true at the highest level. But I think an impact entrepreneur really is a bit of a redundancy these days. As you know well, 50% of the population is under the age of 40 now, and we all expect companies to be doing great profitably, but also to be doing good for the world. And by the way, you can have both at once. Mm-hmm. You know, YouTube and Google get a ton of flack because the 800-pound gorilla always does. But the reality is they really work their asses off to make sure that they're doing great by creators, but also good for the world. And I think net-net, they're very positive. And I look at Gold House and all the work that I do is the same way. We can make money while also saving lives in new ways. And we now have an imperative to do so.
Well, let's talk about that and the work you've been doing at Gold House to elevate and amplify voices, to bring awareness not only to the history of anti-Asian racism in America, but also what's being done to stop it today. So as this last year has unfolded, and we've all seen these horrifying numbers and seen these really disturbing videos that people are now paying much more attention to some of these attacks, tell me about how you've been processing that, both taking that in and thinking about what you can do in response to it.
Yeah, I think it's probably threefold. I think the first natural reaction to a community that hasn't faced this overt sort of, you know, attack or ostracism or violence in a very long time is just shock and confusion of why. And then it's sort of matched with this enormous bout of fury and fear. Fear not only from my mother, but also candidly fear for myself. You know, I'm not the biggest person in the world, but I'm 5'10", I'm 180 pounds. You know, I can squat 300. You know, I can hit people very hard, unfortunately. And I'm scared, you know, I remember the moment was when I was in downtown, and that day, that evening, in fact, when it was still daylight, there was a 37-year-old Asian guy who is very healthy, who's actually a fixture in the New York City tech ecosystem, was stabbed, can now no longer walk, by the way, for several months, and lost a kidney. Now, thank God he can actually walk, and that'll be in 9 months. But that was the moment when we all looked at each other, and we had this text thread saying, that is literally us, right? And these people just do not care. Right. And so I think that that's the first. But I am my mother's son, so we're very resilient. So then we go to think about sort of the duality of solutions. And we think about at Gold House this sort of what I call seeds and weeds, because we're annoying, of how we actually rectify this sort of societal injustice. The idea is you need seeds or socioeconomic abundance, new economic opportunities, new reshaping of media to not only help us, but other communities. And that's the root of the problem. People, by psychological empirical evidence, do not wake up deciding to be racist. That's not the way racism works. Racism is an artificially constructed institution by humans, right? And so the reason this happens is because A, people don't feel like they are seen or treated properly in the streets. And that is largely because of media's fault. The second issue is because they can't pay the bills. Like, people forget, we just went through the greatest economic recession in history a decade ago. We are about to go through another one because the majority, a heavy percentage in double digits of small businesses are not going to come back, right? Especially those on Main Street. And so how do we sort of inject new opportunities there? Happy to elaborate there. The second, though, is weeds. We know we can't just be sunshine and rays all day long. We know that we need corrective and punitive measures when the seeds inevitably fall short. Mm-hmm. And so this is a matter of not only safety precautions locally, which, as you know very, very well, the community is divided on this, right? The answer is not necessarily more policing, because as we hopefully relearned last summer, that can overly penalize certain communities when the majority of attackers right now are not people of color, right? So there's a lot of convoluted sort of challenge there. Second is also community-driven support. So there's a lot of bystander training. Third is legal services and mental health services. And people forget, last month was not only APOM, but last month was also Mental Health Awareness Month. APIs actually have the highest rate of clinical depression and suicide next to the indigenous community of any demographic, right? And so making sure that as a victim, you're not just physically safe, but mentally safe is important. And then the final piece that we've actually put a lot of focus on is financial duress. So a lot of the overwhelming percentage of attackees have been lower income folks, also women and elders, of course. And when you, A, may not be employed, and B, in this country, your healthcare is inexplicably tied to employment, when you receive that inevitable $30,000 hospital bill, that can be life damaging. Right. And so we've, partnered up with GoFundMe and Musa Tariq and his incredible team over there. We've created what is still the largest single API attack fundraiser to date. It's millions to local grassroots organizations for restorative justice, millions more to victims, whether they need a car or just hospital bills. So that's been our sort of top line approach. How do we, again, inject these seeds for longer term societal stability, not just for us, but for all communities? And then secondly is how do we weed things out? Happy to go into the specific on the former as well.
One of the things I want to talk about and pull out from what you just mentioned, because it's not any one thing, right? There's a lot of different layers. There's a lot of different factors at play here when you talk about this. You did such an elegant job of weaving that all together. It's not just about historical differences and racism, but economic recession and, yes, and hardship in communities today, and who is the most vulnerable among us. There's That's questions right. coming in now, and I want to weave these into our conversation. There's a lot of questions when we talk about people being attacked. The obvious question is, well, who's doing the attacking? And as you rightly pointed out, the vast majority, according to the data that we have, the majority of these anti-Asian attacks are being carried out by white people. But there's been a focus on a few that have been carried out by other people of color because of this historical kind of wedge that's been driven by white institutions between communities of color. Talk to me a little bit about what you're seeing there and also some of the solidarity you've seen in response to these attacks.
Yeah, I appreciate you bringing this up right on the head on us so much. We get this all the time. Whenever, I'll be explicit, whenever Goldhouse posts anything in support of the Black community, the immediate response, and it's always from a Twitter profile with no profile picture, it's just a silhouette, it's always privatized, no followers, right? It says, who's attacking y'all? And we all know what they want us to say, and it's a lie. And where does this come from is sort of a bigger question. It comes from, unfortunately, many different places, because all evil, is gray. One is, there's just an immense amount of colorism within the API community. I mean, you see a disproportionate percentage of models in the Philippines, second biggest API ethnicity, are light skin. You still see white cream being sold in India, right? And this, of course, is a remnant of UK imperialism. And so number one is colorism still persists within the API community. And that is a long way of saying darker in too many communities within API groups is seen as bad. Mm-hmm. The second place in domestically is, of course, in the 1960s. As you know, one of our four sort of pernicious narratives against us is known as the model minority myth. Model minority, of course, is a term that was coined by a white person to weaponize the API community against the Black community who were fighting for our collective civil rights, both leading us, but then also with us in the case of interracial marriage. Now, the reason this, of course, happened is the single supremacy or the white incumbency saw, oh, look, here are these no do-gooders who are causing too much trouble and making too much noise. Don't do that. Instead, look at these other folks who aren't white as well, but look how educated, high income, and gainfully employed they are. And most importantly, look how docile they are. they're being quiet and still able to thrive in society. And what happened was a couple of things. Number one, you stoke colorism in the form of anti-blackness within the API community. Number two, you stoke anti-API-ness in the black community. And then three is when minorities fight each other, as you know, there's only one group that wins, and that is the old majority. And so you've just created this insane intra-conflict within communities, intra-conflict within the API community, because we forget we also have the widest income disparity. And then you also perpetuate an old system that doesn't benefit any of us. And we've seen that actually persist over decades, right? And it's still something within us that we have to dismantle. Now, the question is then, how do we dismantle something that we've been handed? It's not even handed, it's been pushed on us, right? Especially given younger generations. I think one, I am optimistic that again, the 50% of people under the age of 40 are smarter, as it were, because we've been more exposed because of connectivity and so forth to other cultures, and therefore have been more open-minded and collaborating. A second genealogical benefit is the growth rate of mixed race births is now outpacing non-mixed race births. And it's driven heavily by the API diaspora and Latino communities. By the way, to tie this a little bit to colorism, there are Black Asians, there are also Brown Asians, as you know well, right? And so this sort of exactly. And so this sort of intersectional mixed race birth, but also just natural like complexion is a really important critical genealogical helper to fortifying greater allyship. And then the third piece that I think about, and this goes back to a little bit of the seeds and weeds, is we're kidding ourselves that we're going to unwind this baggage within a year and a summer of reckoning and a spring of attacks. That's not going to happen. Like all relationships, this takes time. But I am convinced that the time will revolve around two elements, and that is affirmation and adversity. As we learned it the good way in the 1960s, it is because of one minority group that all minorities groups can rise. In that case, the Black community. It's because the Black community, we have favorable immigration policies, are able to vote, have interracial marriage, so forth and so on. And obviously, we were also complicit there in the case of interracial marriage before the Supreme Court with a Filipino lawyer. But today, the question is, what are we all fighting? One example is we are all fighting voter suppression. There are over 100 voter suppression laws around the country right now, specifically targeting people of color. And that's a place where, as the fastest growing electorate in the API community, we have a responsibility to show up not only for ourselves to register, but also other multicultural folks. So that's adversity. What are we collectively fighting? The other side, to quote Star Wars, that quoted another thing, is we don't just want to be defined by what we hate, but also by what we love. Because the reality is, life is short. We can't just be sad. And going back to abundance thinking, we need to grow the pie. We can't just fight a pie that is already cut up and handed to us. And we think there are two areas where all of us are fighting the collective, or one thing I should say, the collective love. And that is one, reshaping public opinion about our community and media. To your point earlier, why are a disproportionate majority of faces of attackers Black on TV when a minority in reality are? That is a systemic problem, and it reeks of racism. And that is fixable on the news floor, by the way. So that's number one. How do we reshape public opinion through media? And it's not just through news. It's through scripted stories and TV, film, and so forth. This is a complex matter of cultural consultation, language accessibility, financing the right projects, and also making sure on the distribution side, these are given the editorial promotion and marketing dollars of traditional, let's say, content. The second side is economics, right? We know that multiculturally owned small businesses have by far been the hardest hit during the pandemic. Mm-hmm. This is partly because many of us don't have access to technology and can't come online. This is heavily because many of us didn't have a pre-existing relationship with the bank for a PPP loan. The list goes on and on and on and on. And not to play a Prussian Olympics, API-owned businesses, small businesses, were actually the hardest hit. And by the way, to create further sort of compounding factor, API-owned businesses by women, and this is not a ding against women, this is because of the systemic bias against women-owned businesses, have been the hardest hit. And so all of us want to not only be seen properly, but all of us need to pay the bills. All of us have more. All of us have kids, right? Or not all of us. You know what I mean. Many of us have kids. Some of us have kids we don't know about. And so how do we pay for them in a way that is sustainable? And this is not just a sort of political platitude of we need to save Main Street because mainstream is the backbone of this country. Real talk, the two reasons we need to save small businesses are one, because they are the nuanced, niche survivors and providers for their local local communities and a nation that is consistently becoming more diverse. And you cannot just speak to someone with broad sweeping strokes. You have to be specific with them. The second reason is 20%, and I know you'll be proud of this too, 20% of the businesses worth over $500 million founded in the last decade have at least one Asian American or Pacific Islander founder in this country, which means that 7.1% of the population that looks like us is providing 20% of the economic growth. That is billions of market dollars of market value, tens of thousands of jobs, if not more. Wow. And more importantly, they're reimagining industry. I mean, these are Zoom, Stitch Fix, DoorDash, et cetera. Yeah. And so the other reason is those companies were not born worth billions of dollars. These companies all started in garages and bedrooms and their 7-year-old mother's birthday house with 50 people, right? And so that's the other practicality. We have to invest in small businesses because one day they can be very big.
So it's not just small businesses at this point, which of course we talk about the engine of economic growth in so many communities, but in this moment of organizing and activism, is there something different about the response you've seen from the AAPI community as compared to generations in the past? You mentioned, of course, in the 1960s, the Black-led civil rights movement. We know that there were Asian Americans participating in that, supporting, showing up in solidarity. The term Asian American was born from that time period in American history. But today, you have people like you, impact entrepreneurs, right? You have the new TAAF, the Asian American Foundation, which is pulling together millions and millions of dollars from these very successful AAPIs and putting it towards organizing and supporting the community. So is there something different today than there was a generation ago?
As you know, as humans, it unfortunately takes disaster for us to wake up. It takes cancer, unfortunately, for you to realize how valuable your life is. It takes a divorce for you to realize what love really means, so forth and so on. And so with this case, it will take us being attacked to bring us together. But at the same time, as you alluded to earlier, it cannot just be hate that keeps us together. It is going to be things that we want and love and things that will grow the pie to be bigger, not just for us, but for others, that will keep this going. And I think you've seen that throughout history. You know, absolutely, the Black community has been ostracized more than any other community because their history was stolen from them through slavery. But also, let's look at how they've successfully erected institutions that are for and by them, but have generated billions of dollars of value, whether it's in music with hip hop and R&B, whether it's in, you know, the Black Wall Streets of the world, whether it's within the proliferation of Black focused funds, right? This is not just about, you know, fighting things that we don't want. This is about taking and building things that we love and that we dream about, right? And that's how the world gets bigger, right? It's how we avoid splitting a pie again that we've been lied to has to be ours.
What you're saying is resonating. People are saying, bake a new pie. You got to bake a new pie.
It's true. And everybody loves pie.
Another question from, who doesn't like pie?
Everybody loves pie.
Another question from someone out there I want to put to you, and this is just putting it in practical everyday terms, because you mentioned you yourself have been worried about going out on the street. You're worried about your family, worried about your mother. Like, when you're seeing this surge of violence, and it does seem so random, and it does seem so brutal at times, what can you tell people out there when they're asking about practical ways, ways that you make yourself feel safe, ways you can help protect your AAPI friends? What would you say?
Yeah, so this will be very, very specific. One is you should be walking in broad daylight. If you're not walking in broad daylight on dense streets, you need to be careful. The end. I'll be honest, after 10 p.m., and again, I'm a large person who can run fast and hit hard, I take the cab. And I don't like taking the cab because it's expensive. I'm usually on the subway, but I take the cab these days. And I'm going to take the cab for a while. Right?
That is specifically to keep yourself safe right now.
Specifically just to keep myself safe. Yeah. So that's number one. You need to be on dense streets in broad daylight, ideally not alone. The second piece is everyone needs to be carrying pepper spray. Now, oddly, in New York City, where I usually am, pepper spray is illegal to buy, but legal to use in self-defense, which makes absolutely no sense to me, but it is what it is. So go to Philadelphia. It's a 2-hour SEPTA train. Come back. Get pepper spray. There's a lot of people as well who are giving out free pepper spray on the weekends and so forth. But that's number two. You got to protect yourself. Number three is bystander support. The disproportionate percentage of people who are being attacked, again, are low-income women and elders, right? Now, I'm not going to make comments on who is vulnerable, who's not. But the reality is these are the three demographics by the numbers. And therefore, those of us who are not those three have a disproportionate responsibility to help those three. If I see another video of bystanders not supporting attacking, I'm going to lose it. And so availing yourself of I holler back at Asian Americans Advancing Justice's incredible bystander support, and other resources like that are really helpful. Just to fly through them very quickly, y'all can Google them. It's called the 5 D's, because all things are alliterative. Just to give you a couple, one tactic is to direct. Some of us are, when you see something, you should say something. And unfortunately, science has proven that humans need to hear something 3 to 7 times to internalize it. So don't just yell stop once, you have to yell it 3 to 7 times, right? Number two is to delegate. Some of us are not physically or emotionally prepared to intervene. That's okay. But someone else, surely, especially if you're in dense city, could be. And if not, just yell out for help, right? And direct other people explicitly to go help them. Three is to distract. So this is the whole, you remember that Pixar film where that dog said squirrel because he was really easily distracted. When you neutralize someone with randomness, it actually works because they get very confused. So one of the easiest things is you can physically step closer and say, excuse me, do you have the time, right? It's just something that everyone knows that's sort of neutral, right? And something that everyone knows so therefore they can help. The fourth is delay. There's, of course, a direct correlation between delaying or the amount of time lapse and the lack of heat or attack, because so many of these attacks are senseless but in the heat of a moment, right? And then there's another D that you'll have to Google and you can find out for yourself to make sure you did your homework. But anyway, the 5 D's honestly have been so profoundly helpful. And speaking of allyship, they've been so valuable because it was the exact same tactics that I hollered back created for Black Lives Matter so that we can all be agents of change and support for our Black friends, right? So anyway, so that's the third. And then the fourth thing is, these are all near term, but the fourth thing is legislatively helping. Congresswoman Grace Meng has been doing a phenomenal job and consistently across the pandemic fighting for our collective rights on paper. She just got her hate crime bill passed, of course, and she's working on several other efforts, but making sure that we support our legislators who actually care about us when we don't have something to sell them and give them is really, really important, and she's among the best. Outside of all those is, of course, the longer term work. Now, the problem, I'll be the first to say it, with 70% of Gold House's work, which is focused on the seeds, is we're not going to see the fruits of that labor for a year at least, right? Mm-hmm. And we give out grants and so forth to small businesses, but we know bringing a business online, getting them to stability, investing in new films, that's a 3 to 5 year at least investment, if not a generational investment, even though it's the root of the problem. So that would be the other stuff. But again, we need that sort of dual approach at once for everybody.
So final thoughts, and it's a big question. I apologize, I'm leaving it this way, but I'm combining some of our audience questions with this. As folks are asking about, for all this work, for all the activism, the money, the organizing and so on, does this get better when the pandemic goes away, as we move out of this period that seems to have sparked this surge with all the work you're doing? Does it get better?
You wouldn't be doing your job if you didn't end with the hard question. Let me give you a BS answer that my mother would say, and not that she's full of BS, and then I'll give you the other practical.
We're going to give her a chance to defend herself in a minute, too.
Fair enough. She's right behind me. It's still her birthday as far as she's concerned, so she gets privilege. Life is not about getting better or worse. Life is about getting through it. And there will always be hell that comes through us, and it's not a matter of whether things improve. It's whether we survive. So I think that's the philosophy. This is going to still be tough. Now, where are things going to be tough? One, I do think some things might sort of reduce in their attention, partly because I'm worried that media will forget it because we're in cultural carouseling in society now. I'm going to get in trouble for saying this. Last summer, every media company and its mother said that Black voices and Black stories matter. I question how much they still mean that right now. I question how many dollars they're still putting to Black stories in a sincere and sustainable way. And I'm worried that our stories too, and this is why I'm so grateful to you and journalists like you on that for creating space continuously after APOM, I'm worried the news is going to forget about it. The second thing I worry about is as people go back out in the streets, because we have all been doubly vaccinated and vaccines are good, I'm worried that violence actually reduces because there are more people. I don't know if that's actually true. Mm-hmm. And that's the second compounding factor. The third factor is Biden has, as you saw last week, created this accelerated commission to understand the origins of COVID-19. Now, the AAPI community is already dealing with yellow peril, where everyone thinks it was our fault. It was not our fault. We did not create COVID-19. I was probably in a buffet restaurant when it happened, right? Eating my face out and forgetting it was thinking that summer was going to be canceled.
The more this conversation perpetuates, that adds to the tension, that adds to this perception, right?
There's no question. Yeah. And it already, you know, will gas up a fire of this latent sort of soft conflict that the two greatest superpowers have already been at odds in. Now, I love what Biden said, and I think it's greatly aspirational that at worst, we are in competition. At best, we are in collaboration. One can dream. But let's look at what's actually happening right now. And I worry about that. So will this get better or worse? There's a lot of reasons this is about to get tough. But the reality is when things get tough, we have to get tougher. And so don't wonder whether this will get better. Know that we will, as we have before, not just within our community through internment and exclusion, but through all multicultural communities. And I specifically say multicultural communities because we have disproportionate struggle from the single supremacy, that we will survive. But we have to be smart about this. And we have to be smart through dual approaches like seeds and weeds. And we have to be smart about just supporting each other and creating spaces just as you are on that.
Bing Chen, president and co-founder of Gold House. First and foremost, we also need to just say happy birthday to your mother.
Because so
a bunch of people on here are sending out their birthday messages. So thank you to her for sharing you with us on her birthday weekend. I apologize for the intrusion.
No, it's my fault. I thought I was ready and the house was not ready.
You're never ready. You're never ready. Not ready till mama's ready. But thank you, Bing. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you for making the time. And let people know where they can follow you and the work you do. Shout out your handles.
Gold House just is Gold House Co, as in collective, on every major platform. And I'm just Bing Chen, B-I-N-G, like Bing Crosby, not the search engine, and C-H-E-N, the second most common Asian last name. That is true. After Lee. Anna, it's such a privilege. Thank you again for making this space. I want everyone to know, and especially in the hallowed halls of PBS NewsHour, it may seem obvious that Amna creates space for this and she can just snap her fingers and it happens. But the reality is, as a journalist, it's so hard to create space for something that by the numbers, so much of old media still thinks is small. So well done to you and your fortitude for continuing to shuffle this.
Thank you. I'll accept that on behalf of the entire team that it takes to pull these together every week. So shout out to them too. Thank
Yay,
you
Wyatt.
To you, Bing. Thank you to everyone out there for joining. Guys, real quick before you go, we're going to be back here next week. It is Pride, of course. And so we're going to be having a conversation with the creators of the Lesbian Bar Project. We're going to talk about the diminishing number of lesbian bars across the country and why it's important to maintain those spaces. We talk a lot about the spaces we create, the ones we maintain. That's an important conversation that's going to come on June the 9th. So thank you for being here, Bing Chen. Thank you to all of you.
Okay.
And I'll see you back here soon.
Thank you, Amna. Thank you, Wyatt.